I gave people all the stuff they really needed. Social security checks, utility bills, TV guide.
I want a TV guidance counselor. TV guidance counselor. Stand up to watch all night, and everything's gonna be alright with my TV guidance counselor.
Hey everybody, welcome to TV Guidance Counselor. I, as always, am Ken Reed. I am your TV Guidance Counselor. I am the Boston-based stand-up comedian who has been doing this podcast since Valentine's Day 2014. Not continuously, but each and every week. Haven't missed a week yet. This is the show where we usually grab an old issue of TV Guide magazine and from my personal collection and discuss the television we watched growing up, the television we made, all those sorts of fun things, using the back issue as the inspiration, let's say, for our discussion. But not always. Sometimes I have someone on the show who is just a fascinating person who's done a ton of work, and we don't even need the TV Guide, but we discuss a lot of TV, and that is the case this week, where my guest is the one and only Will McRobb. And if you are unfamiliar with Will McRobb, then maybe this is the first time you've listened to this show. But Will is the co-creator of The Adventures of Pete and Pete, in addition to a bunch of other amazing stuff. But if you know me, you know how much of a massive Pete and Pete fan I am, and how the stuff Will worked on really set the tone for so much of the stuff I love in this world. And he gives his philosophy of how the four quadrants of what makes those things, and it's pretty perfect. Also, Will is introducing a documentary. I think it's this week, or it might have been last week, but it is about the band The Embarrassment. It is called We Were Famous, You Don't Remember The Embarrassment, who are a band that was inspirational to Pete and Pete. I can't wait to see this documentary. And if you have the means, if they're playing the documentary somewhere in your town, go see it or go to LA. It's fun. Anyway, I had a great time talking to Will. I cannot thank him enough for taking the time to sit down and talk with me, and you will enjoy this. If you enjoy this even half as much as I did, this will be your favorite thing ever. So please sit back, relax, and enjoy this week's episode of TV Guidance Counselor with my guest, Will McRobb.
TV is my friend, and it has been always there for me in time of need.
Live via satellite, Will McRobb, how are you, sir?
I'm very good. Happy to be talking to you.
I'm so happy to have you. I have mentioned so many things you've worked on the show over and over again. As people know, Pete and Pete is one of my all-time favorite shows. And I've both Danny and Mike have been on the show several times. But I don't know if a lot of people know that you did a ton of other fascinating stuff before that sort of led up to that, and obviously after that as well. But I thought we'd kind of get into that a little bit. But sure. First, I want to talk about you. Did you grow up in New York proper?
I grew up in Ithaca, New York.
And okay.
Yeah, and so I had a really like Pete and Pete childhood to some degree. You know, a lot of stories in Pete and Pete came from based on real stories. And it was nice to just explore the childhood adventures of a kid in such a great city to live in, and just excise all the stuff that's kept me in therapy all these years.
Chris Koch grew up in the town I grew up in Melrose, Mass. So I always sort of and I knew that too as a kid. So it was a very similar vibe, probably, to Ithaca that you grew up in as well. It seems like everyone who kind of worked on that show kind of locked into that suburban mythology pretty easily.
If you had that background, you can relate to it more, but if you never had that background, it probably seems even more fantastic, which is probably even better. What's going on here? Why is everyone happy and playing?
Well, it's I always say that what you really did was manage to create a show that felt like what it actually felt like to be a kid, because everything is life or death and cranked up to this surreal way that's what being a kid feels like.
Yeah, that's what that was like. Working at Nickelodeon and Nick at Night, we'll talk about that a bit, but Nickelodeon at the time, it was just in its infancy, but they were really hardcore about trying to inspire kids, and they didn't really have the shows to do it. They were still kind of getting the cheapest things they could find, and you know, and they relied a lot on the promo department to, you know, to try to fill in the gaps between the vision and the TV shows they had. And so the promo department was almost like its own, like, you know, elite division of sort of like top secret, you know, promoters of like the kid point of view. Because, you know, when I remember when I, how I got the job was my second job out of grad school was working for Goldman Sachs and doing corporate video. And, you know, you can imagine what that was like. And then I, you know, I got lucky, and a friend of mine from Syracuse, where I went to grad school, recommended me to one of the producers in the promo department. And my audition, speaking of old shows that need a lot of help to seem like they're not just, you're not just watching cable access or something, was a Rin Tin Tin movie. And so I did my thing, and I got the job. And, you know, in a way, in a weird way, a lot of stuff I ended up doing was kind of comparable to a Rin Tin Tin movie. You know, just how do we make this feel like it's not 60 years old, and you know, there's either, you know, for Nick and I, it was like, here's what's funny about it, and we're going to frame it in a way that makes you feel like it's not just some crappy, you know, it was all about image and creating a personality for the network. And, you know, that was yeoman's work, because, you know, some shows, you know, who doesn't want to watch Mr. Ed? That was one of the shows at the time. But who wants to watch, you know, say Donna Reed, you know? So
yeah.
The overall gestalt of Nick at Night was everybody on that team, like six or seven people, they all had slightly different, you know, senses of humor and points of view, but it always came down to, I think I was always on, there were some people that had no affection for the shows and just wanted to kind of like expose it, you know, just try to like, it's so bad, it's good kind of a mentality. And mine always was, I could always find in the shows I was working on something that like was connected to my overall emotional, like, a connection with shows that I loved. And that, you know, that typically involved, it eventually became kind of like a catchphrase for Chris Viscardi and I, you know, when we were doing Pete, but, we kind of boiled down our whole aesthetic, and this aesthetic kind of started with the, you know, promoting, what was kind of like, you know, Green Acres, or something like that, was, you know, try to, everything you do, can be, well, if you have all four of these ingredients, then you're onto something, whether you're watching something or trying to write something. And that was, funny, sad, strange, and beautiful. And, you know, I, you know, the best work I, you know, I couldn't always be doing that, but whenever I had a chance to kind of find, those four ingredients, you know, that's what I would promote. And then, of course, Pete and Pete started off as promos, you know, 60-second stories. And sometimes I think that's the best version of Pete and Pete, were those super dense 60-second stories. But from there onward to the series, it was always like, you know, you're a fan of the show, so you can identify those ingredients in almost everything you saw.
Absolutely. And to your point, the sort of promo vibe that you guys were creating, it wasn't so bad, it's good. It wasn't watching stuff with irony. There was like a reverence there, and you were just finding interesting angles, like oh my God, Patty Duke show, which was never one of my favorite shows, but the angle like you took for the promos was like showcasing the behind the headshot double of like Patty's double.
Oh, you saw that?
Of course, it was like a whole campaign.
I worked on that. I worked on that with Chris. I think that was the first time we worked together. And I mean, what kind of place is going to let you, other than Nick at Night, is going to let you do like 10, whatever, 8 segments, you know, in between shows that are about this actress who never got any recognition for being the backup Patty Duke's head and treating it really seriously. So I'm glad you saw that.
Yeah, it was done like a hard news piece almost with the voiceover and all that kind of stuff. Because so MTV Networks and Nickelodeon and Nick at Night were all kind of in the same, under the same banner at that time, right?
Yeah, we were part of MTV Networks as an umbrella.
And MTV Networks also for their promos, sort of famously at the time, would kind of go to the art schools and art colleges and have people do like image pieces. And
yeah,
we got all those weird empty from like really underground, you know, strange artists that still shock me to this day when I go back and look at those. And again, there's the promo department. So that sort of vibe of not anything goes, but they were more open to you bringing in some more experimental, almost punk kind of weird stuff in the promos, because why not?
Yeah, it's true. MTV and Nickelodeon, Nick and I kind of got started around the same time. And yeah, you're right. There's a lot of crossover on these sort of new ideas that needed to be kind of like polished and, made, you know, how do you make something cool, you know, in MTV for such a long time? They, it was cool, but you always felt like there was an entry point. And if there wasn't, as sometimes was the case with some of the things you're describing, it didn't matter because it just was so, even though you couldn't understand why you loved it, it made a big impact on you, you know?
Yeah. If I look at a show like Remote Control, which is really like the, in the Venn diagram of MTV and Nick at Night, that show is kind of, that's like the Rosetta Stone of those three networks in one show almost, even though it was an MTV show. But you have that sort of irreverent nostalgia for, you know, latchkey kids in the TV we grew up in, but also with this sort of 50s via the 80s aesthetic. And, you know, it kind of manages to incorporate all those things. And the thing that really resonated with me, especially about the Nick at Night stuff, as someone who is a little bit younger and didn't necessarily grow up with those shows the first time, is you were sort of at the very tail end of that generation of people who grew up watching TV and then started making TV. Because before that, it was all people who came from radio or film or some other world. They didn't have all the, you know, TV where they were sort of inventing it as they went along. And I feel like your generation of creators managed to sort of incorporate all of our language of 30, 40 years of television into the TV you made in a great way.
Yeah, it's true. It was like in our DNA. So, I was too, I was born early enough to watch like Donna Reed, you know, some of those shows, and Southern Show.
Lassie.
I hope you didn't watch that. but there was just something so, even a show that you maybe wouldn't have watched if, you know, if I was 80 years old and I was growing up with it, there was just something just so damn charming about, you just fall in love with the effort, or, you know, because it was your job, you just had to find a way to see it. Like with me, that funny, sad, strange, and beautiful. If I could identify anything that had that, then I was on board, you know, and that's why I was such a big fan of, I'm still mocked for it, but, and I can't completely explain, I might be able to, why I loved it so much, but I was the resident expert on My Three Sons, which it's a pretty benign show, but yeah. There was something about it that, maybe it was, I never knew that Bub, you know, from Lucy was like the live-in uncle for the first four or five seasons. Then it switched over to good old Uncle Charlie. But I don't know, there's just some pathos to this, no mom and, and McMurray with his pipe. I don't know. I guess it just was really comforting, and it was fun to think of different ways to talk about it.
And that's a show that I never would have watched if not for the promos. Like that, this is Bub, this is Uncle Charlie promo, which you might have worked on.
That was Dave Pittorti, I think. That, he was another great one of the greats. It was brilliant. I remember. Yeah, I can probably quote that word verbatim. It was such a great story.
I still have the promo of adding lyrics to the My Three Sons theme song. Where it's like, My Three Sons on Nick at Night. I'm like, yeah. I can't hear it without that.
That's what, there was a first wave of the people were like me, but didn't include me, included like the first generation of the promo department. And then I kind of came in part two, where some of the veterans were still there. And that was such a great place to learn how to do it, because, they'd be doing it for like 2 or 3 years. And I look at some of the stuff that was done before me back when they were really inventing how to do it. And they seem like stone cold classics to me, like the one you're describing, and lots of great Donna Reed ones. Like the cornier the show was, the more you know, you could play with it. And, you know, that that's a show that's even more makes my three sons look like, you know, pro wrestling. And and yet people wrote the best, probably the best spots were for Donna Reed, because she was so sweet. It was so bland. And you sort of fell in love with her, and then it gave you like the motivation to write something that embraced her, and then also kind of like at the same time teased her a little bit. You know?
I mean, I was watching like Nick at Night and the Night Flight on USA Network, which would have stuff like Church of the Subgenius and would show like Atomic Cafe and all this stuff sort of all fit together. Like, it didn't seem, you know, that far away, the sort of vibe of all this stuff. And, you know, it's sort of all in my mind, it all melds together. But like My Three Sons, I never would have been interested in if not for those. And the more I learn about it as an adult, the more I'm kind of fascinated by how weird that show is. Cause what was on like 14 or 15 seasons. So you literally see these kids grow up.
I read that Fred McMurray, would show up, and he would just do all his scenes like right away, get them over, and then he'd go away and they would shoot the rest of the show.
Well, the reason they did the show was because Fred McMurray wanted to go on summer vacation. So he was like, because he was a huge movie star. Right, and so he was like, I don't want to work in the summer, so can I get a TV show? And they were like, sure. Yeah, and he would shoot all his stuff in a month, and then they would shoot the rest of the season without him. I had Chip on, I can't think of the actor's name now and I feel bad, but he was saying like, so they would have to shoot all their stuff when he wasn't there. And there was one scene where he had a scene with McMurray, and they didn't get to shooting the rest of it till like 6 months later, but he had completely grown out of his wardrobe. So there was like all this bizarre stuff, and they're like, what are they gonna do? It's gotta shoot it like as it is. It's like, all right, we're just, and that's bizarre. And like Donna Reed, huge movie star. When I've gone back and watched that show now, I realize that shows she's like a crazy person. Like every plot on that show is her being completely insane or some totally weird, unreasonable thing that she's concocted. And you're like, she's out of her mind.
I know. I think that kind of, you bring up a good point about her, like along with like, you know, all the things that made it feel promotable, and you kind of fell in love with her, et cetera. But also, you're right, there was like the arrangement too, and that also was fun to obsess with. A lot of the great spots were just like, you know, obsessing over her obsessions, you know, like being perfect all the time, you know?
Or like you play a lot on like conspiracy theory stuff or almost tabloidy stuff, like, did you know this was really about this? But it's something patently ridiculous that it definitely wasn't about. And I loved that stuff. And were they... Did you have a lot of oversight on that, or did they kind of let you do whatever you wanted?
Well, more or less, you know, we would get assignments, and, you know, it was, you couldn't always get the show you wanted, but, you know, they're all in their own way back in that period. They were all, you know, great. Like, I think I was mentioning to you in an email that there were certain situations, too, where you felt like you had to write promo. You loved the show so much, and it was doing so badly in the ratings that you wanted to save it, you know. And like I told you with Green Acres, I didn't know much about it before I started watching it, and I saw all the great writers that were on it, and then understood how you know, unexpectedly surreal it is when you consider the premise. But then again, they do have a talking pig, but I just didn't think people were getting the show the way they should be getting it. So I was trying to push this idea that what you might think is stupid, because you know it's Green Acres, is really like experimental and surreal, and you know, way ahead of like anything, in you know, 10 years ahead of anything else that tried to be that postmodern about it. And I don't think it worked, but I really felt like I got to go to bat for Green Acres. People got to know what I figured out. It's audacious, you know. It's hilarious. You just have to look past the dumb, you know, hick, you know, city folks in the country plot, which is, you know, pretty standard fare. But you know, like I guess was it Jeb? Was that the handyman?
Yeah, yeah.
He was like Andy Kaufman. You know?
Oh yeah. Oh, it was insane. Ann Magnuson's a big fan of Green Acres, and we were talking about it, and she calls it surreal, which is kind of perfect. But I sort of picked up on that from your promos, and as a kid, I loved this Green Acres, and as you would imagine, not super popular to talk about on the playground. But to this day, I carry the torch for how innovative that show is. And the thing I always show people is the running gag they would have where Ava Gabor could see the credits.
Oh, yeah. I was just thinking that.
She's like, it's the names again. The names are here. And they're like, what are you talking about? She's like, look, there they are. And as a kid, I was like, what? She could see the credits. Like, that's insane.
I know. I was trying to think of shows that were on the same wavelength. And it happened to be one of my favorite shows. You know, it wasn't quite as, like, intentional, but it was just part of the general anarchy of the show, was the Monkees, you know, mm-hmm. that, you know, they let you know you're on a set, or they would make jokes about, you know, inside jokes about, you know, things that audiences don't usually get to hear about. So that was a sort of playful, like, anarchy. And, you know, I loved the show for that. Like, it's a, you know, I don't know, someone should do a story about the history of you know, shows being self-aware that they're shows. It's such a great gimmick, and you know, now it's as old as the sun, but back then, you know, you went from like Gilligan's Island to Green Acres, you know, and it's like, what happened in that year?
Yeah, how did this become self-aware? Because you know, that stuff, and this sort of gets to Pete and Pete as well, I feel like had Pete and Pete been made 5 or 6 years later, it probably would have been an animated series and not a live action series. Yeah. Yeah. And it would have still been great, but not the same. It would not have been the same thing. Like that live action angle that something like Green Acres has made it stand apart, because like a lot of the jokes in Green Acres weren't that dissimilar to like Bullwinkle, oh, right, which was really smart and doing similar stuff, but it doesn't hit the same way when it's a cartoon.
That's a great, I talk about this all the time because I do a lot of animation work, and you know, I wish half the things that I worked on in animation were live action, because for all the reasons you mentioned. And there were attempts to get like Pete and Pete you know, rebooted as a cartoon, and I always turned it down. It's just like, as I keep saying to people trying to explain it, it's like if it's live action, in a cartoon, anything can happen, you know, yeah, and you go with it. And live action is usually not the case, you know. It's not a cartoon, so it's reality, and you have to kind of play within the rules of reality, or people will disconnect. But with that show, because it was from a kid's perspective, you could make, you know, all the things we did that were kind of out of the box, you accepted because it was a kid perspective. And that's, you know, the best reason to be working on a kid's show was making something like Pete and Pete. You know, sometimes you feel like maybe I should do something more adult, but for that show, you couldn't have gotten away with any of that stuff. And I'll tell you a quick story. So we had done a couple the last episode of Pete and Pete. It was like in 1990, end of 1995.
Yep, Saturday.
That's right, Saturday. The show that didn't know it was a finale, but sort of felt like one.
It right? feels like one, yeah.
Yeah, I know. We ended up taking our underground fame to Disney, ABC. They gave us a deal, and we were going to like go to the big time. And actually, that's a sort of a sidebar. We did Snow Day, the movie. That's what I meant to be talking about. And that was like it was shot in 1999 and came out in 2000. And it was so, such, you know, it could have been, in our minds, it could have been a Pete and Pete episode, you know, the
evil, oh, yeah.
You know, we just didn't have any snow. And so we wrote it like that, you know, as best we could to flesh it out as a movie and take that spirit of growing up and, you know, the surrealism that goes along with things that you play straight. And, well, we learned the hard way. And, I'm glad you're a fan of the show. I think we've had a few reunions, and I never felt more touched by how the show, you know, connected with people and made them like. I mean, the big idea for Pete and Pete was, be as weird as you want to be, you know.
Yeah.
And a lot of people were inspired by that, and it felt great all those years later to be like, wow, it worked. Things we were trying to do, but I was with Snow Day. We were trying to do it for Paramount, and we realized that if you watch Pete and Pete, There's not like a lot of laughs in it, you know. It's like it is what it is, and you know, it's got its charms, but it's not like it's designed to have like a lot of punchlines. I mean, sometimes
yeah, it's sort of atmosphere. Like, it's like
yeah,
less,
it's like
yeah.
Everything was yeah, it was more just like because it was so deadpan. You know, like the episode where Dad is racing Phil Hickel, and he's yes. Dad's in a real car, and he's
got the remote control with Buscemi. Yeah,
that's so Pete and Tina, right? It's like nobody's questions it, you know. And in Snow Day, what happened was they tested it, and it, you know, as we learned, you know, our style is not telling, making people crack up. It's creating an atmosphere, a mood, and having things, you know, kind of be magical. You know, that doesn't really isn't really what Paramount wanted, so they had to cut some stuff out that we loved that was very, very Pete and Pete, because they had to figure out how to make it funnier, so they thought. And and this is, if you ever want to just like get depressed, watch Snow Day on streaming, and you'll see exactly what they did to it and why it made us feel like maybe Pete and Pete was like once in a lifetime stroke of lightning, you know, and it might be impossible to really bring that back to anything, you know, make a movie about it or do a series on, you know, on a bigger platform. And that was, there's a heavy set kid that's part of like the little, you know, our version of the little Pete gang. And, you know, they're the strike force to stop Snowplow Man from, you know, plowing the streets. And every time, there was like three or four times where it seemed sort of believable because the kid was bending over or something. They would add a fart.
Of course.
And then in the remaining like 20, there was no physical behavior that suggested that someone's going to fart. He would just be like, drink a glass of water, fart. And and man, I'm still crying about it, you know. It just took our Pete and Pete universe and added the most like cheapening, you know, just like crowd pleasing. And then the worst part was, and this is where I really, it took a little while to recover from this. I was standing by the copy machine when they were collating the audience review, cards that kids had, you know, it was before the movie was released. They had kids watch it, and maybe it was a rougher cut, but the farts were in it. And so I'm looking at these individual cards come up, and every time one came up, you know, I could see the question, what did you like best about the show? And, you know, just like chink, 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 chink. And like, I would say 3/4 of like 200 people said when the fat kid farted.
Oh, good God. Good God. Yeah, I mean, it's not like if Paramount had their way, they would have just made fart the movie. Like, it would have been just fat kids farting for 90 minutes, and they would have been like, perfect. It's low budget. Kids love it.
But you can't go wrong. I mean, farts, we all know farts are funny.
Oh, yeah.
It has no place in, you know, it's, you know, just, yeah, like you're saying, instead of putting farts where they don't belong, just make a fart movie, you know,
get somewhere. Just go lean into it. Yeah. I mean, so I was very excited for Snow Day because I knew that it had sort of started as a Pete and Pete movie to the point where I think some of the kids are named like Wayne and like some of the character names, like in the little gang.
Yeah, the character names. And the characters are pretty good. Not great, but it was just like what everybody who gets hired, who did something more underground when they get, you know, enough cult adulation that somebody bigger wants to use them. I think it's a story like probably 10 million, you know, people have gone through. It's just like, what do you think was going to happen? You know, it's not Nickelodeon. It's not Nickelodeon, you know, 1992, right? So,
right. I mean, Nickelodeon changed so much between like those early sort of Jerry Laybourne days and by the mid to late 90s where it was now sort of Disney Channel and all that had kind of started to get like that. It's a very different place from when Pete and Pete came out of, like it definitely felt different.
Yeah. And the problem with Nick at Night too was like, I think they just started making enough money that they could buy quality shows like Cheers and, you know, Taxi. And once you have those shows, you know, and other shows like them that are quality shows, you know, the magic of our approach to trying to make you watch shows that are old, you know, that was that had to, by necessity, be turned into just straight promos. You know?
Yeah,
Cheers, you know.
We all know Cheers. We love it. Yeah,
yeah, it's, we got it. It's great. We got it. You don't have to watch Mr. Ed anymore.
So a couple of things is one. So I saw Sonora opening day. I used to have Tuesdays off from college, so I would go to like the first showing of a movie every Tuesday, and it was me, and then I think it was during a school vacation week, so it was like this family of like six and just me. And so I was laughing at all the sort of Pete and Pete type moments that weren't obvious laugh lines, like, you know, most of Chris Elliott's stuff, which was very much like the Christmas, you know. And so this family would look back at me like terrified because they like didn't understand. They were laughing at the farts, you know, and I'm laughing at like Chris Elliott being like with his bird and all this stuff, and they're like, oh my god, this man's a psycho. But it hit the same exact thing that you felt. I felt, I was like, it was clear to me that Paramount was like didn't know what to do with this. And you know, like that movie would have worked in like a Wes Anderson style. You know what I mean? Yeah, like that kind of smaller movie, but they wanted like a big, big thing. the other thing is that I always am grateful that the world we grew up in television wise, we got shown stuff that was cheap because we got this amazing education and exposure to some incredible stuff we never would have checked out on our own. Like, definitely not. And you know, we see that with Nick and Nite and TV Land, you know, to your point, I don't know, maybe 10 or 15 years ago, I think they stopped showing shows that were more than 5 years old.
I know.
Well, it's like,
you know, it's like, I guess they, you know, they would see it as success. You know, we're making more money, we have better shows. And I kind of get it. It's like the, I mean, just from a business standpoint, you know, the years that we're both like, kind of like praising, I was kind of like, scrappy, punk bands, you know,
yeah,
who are just trying to make something out of nothing. And then once it, you know, it got successful enough to have real shows, it was, you know, it was like ELO or something, you know, super polished and, you know, everything else. So that's just a success curve and creativity downturn that, you know, has been told since the beginning of time.
Well, yeah, when you have all the resources in the world, and if no one ever says no to things you want to do, you tend to make kind of pablum, you know, because you don't have to come up with innovative ideas, or you don't, you know, you don't have to make up for lacks in other areas with more creative stuff, and, you know, which is fine. I mean, I guess most people like that enough, you know, you end up with Jimmy Fallon, you know, versus, you know, something really weird that not everyone will like, but the people who like it will love it. And so, you know, I guess from a business standpoint, that doesn't make money, but that becomes part of like people's souls, you know, it's like it makes people better people, like generations of people, which I think Pete and Pete did, you know, and I don't mean to say that as like an overstatement. It was definitely a show where you like, no one talked down to you, and it made you feel, yeah, it was just, I never saw anything like it, as a kid. And it just resonated so much. I think the only show, did you watch Adventure Time at all?
Oh yeah. I loved it.
Adventure Time. I remember watching when it was airing going, I think this is whatever the kids who are 10 years old, this is their Pete and Pete.
That's a good example of a show that, based on what we were talking before about animation versus live action, like that could not be. I don't think that could be live action.
No, no,
so it we're talking on sense. Terms because it, you know, that would be impossible to make in live action. You know, the budget would be crazy.
It's a very small, like micro genre of shows that fit in that. They feel kind of cartoonish, but they needed to be live action, like Pete and Pete was. Like the only other stuff I can think of is like Savage Steve Holland stuff, which was really only two movies and a TV series that did not do well. The New Adventures of Beans Baxter, which has sort of a similar vibe to it. But the people who love those things love them. And then was it The War Next Door you did?
Oh yeah,
for you USA? Didn't see
that, did you?
I did. I love the USA Network original stuff.
Oh my god, that show is my other than Pete and Pete. That's the second favorite project I ever worked on, and it didn't. It should have done better. It got good reviews, and you know, it was kind of not that out there. It was a high concept, you know, spy and supervillain end up living next door, But I think the problem was that USA was trying to like pivot from like La Femme Nikita to quirky cartoons and a quirky live action, because there was another show that was joined to ours, you know, in an hour long block. Can't remember, something about a town in Arizona. And the audience just like, we need to see miniskirts and guns. I'm sorry. You know?
Yeah. Yeah. They were like, oh, silk stockings is the way to go. Not Duckman.
I know. They never went back there. They never went back there. And so I think ours is just a casualty of like too much of a left turn, you know, from what people are used to watching.
But there was a little blip of time. Like the Weird Science TV series was pretty great.
I never said that. Is it like, you know, equivalent of the movie in terms of quality?
It's better than the movie because it's sort of like an update of I Dream a Genie. It's the thing that makes it great is they remove the creepy sexual stuff, which is like everything in that movie that you're like, ugh. Like, it's just they make Lisa much more childlike and it's much more like they're friends. And so they go in all kinds of weird places and it actually doesn't have a that dissimilar of a vibe to Pete and Pete and that surreal thing that could have been a cartoon, but it would have been a different thing. And then they had, the War Next Door, which I think would you get like 10 episodes?
Yeah, but we made 10 episodes, but only, I think we got canceled after 4. And so those remaining 6, some of them are online, but most of them are lost to history. But I'm glad you watched it because, you know, it was high, you know, maybe that was really a Nick at Night kind of like, my Nick at Night brain was hard at work on that one because it felt like, you know, a premise that could have been, you know, on the basic level, you know, the premise was so high concept it could have been on in the 60s.
Sure.
But of course, you know, we had Damian Young playing the bad guy, so it was going to be cracked as possible.
Because that's a good introduction to sort of a lot of the actors that used on Pete and Pete. A lot of them you got from like Hal Hartley movies.
Yeah. His crew was Hal's crew, and so. We're like, I wonder if we could get, you know, we got a couple people from, well, mostly Damian Young and Stu, I'm not sure, but we did have like the whole Crackerjack crew from Hal Hartley, which is why the show looks so good.
Because we touched on music a little earlier, and were you kind of a punk rock kid growing up, or did you start liking that sort of music later at like college age or in the 80s?
It was before college. I mean, it was like... you know, in Ithaca, they had some college radio stations, and I guess it was, you know, a little, you know, I wasn't a cool kid who was on till, you know, I missed the whole punk period, and what got me into that music was a couple of songs from, like, 78 or 79. It was Police, Joe Jackson, and, of course, primarily, it was Elvis Costello, but the song that I think, you can look at I don't know how your record collection from, you know, that arcs from your dorkier days to your cooler days, but mine is like Steely Dan, Kansas, Boston, and then there's
sure.
Then you get to This Year's Model,
yeah,
and then everything after that's like cool. And so This Year's Model, particular Angels Want to Wear My Red Shoe, that was the turning point. And after that, I never looked back. You know,
yeah, I think Stiff Records did that to a lot of people at that time.
I know, and Elvis is still out. I can't believe it. Like. You know, most guys end up like the Eagles. This is our third farewell tour.
Right.
You know? And Elvis is just like doing real tours with real bands. And
new music.
I know, it's new music.
Yeah.
But, you know, I don't think there's an... I don't know if you read his memoir, fantastic. And, you know, guy can do no wrong.
Because, like, you Wellsville comes from the Embarrassment song, I believe, right?
That's right.
Yeah. Which was a fairly obscure band. I think an Ohio band.
They're from Lawrence, Kansas.
Lawrence, Kansas. They were somewhere in the Midwest. Although the drummer who wrote a lot of the songs moved to Boston, they're still here. I think he was in the Del Fuegos for
a bit? Yeah, he left. The band broke up because, you know, they've been striving for 4 years and nothing was happening. You know, they just went on with their lives. But also the guitarist from the Embarrassment formed Big Dipper, which is a great indie
yes
band. Yeah,
but I mean they sort of have that, you know, your four pillars of making something good sort of is in their music, you know, like the song about Wellsville is sort of there.
I was like, you know, my partner Chris is you know, indulged me with, he doesn't really, isn't that connected to like you know, indie music, but you know, it's like, even, you know, so you could argue like, why am I going to sign off on this obscure band, one song by this obscure band? But Wellsville is a pretty good name for a show like Pete and Pete. And if you've heard the song, it's you know, it basically the message of the song is like the band is on a trip and they could have taken the exit to see Wellsville, but they decided they were behind and they had to keep going. And so the great line of the song that kind of sums it up is like, pass by life, pass by Wellsville, you know. So that's kind of a good way to look at the world we are creating. You know, you could just drive by and you know, and you could miss out on a whole like world that is waiting for you if you just had it, you know, weren't in such a rush, you know.
Yeah, it's that journey versus destination, which I always see, which just comes up in Pete and Pete so much in regards to becoming an adult. Like, don't rush to grow up so much, you know, especially in the second and third season, we get that conflict between Big and Little Pete of, you know, wanting to hang on to being a kid versus I'm an adult now kind of thing.
Yeah, that's true. I mean, the brothers are always, you know, sometimes in conflict, which is always great. And the first season, maybe less so, but by the second season where Big Pete was, you know, like, you know, whatever, 14 or 15, 14 or something, you could really play with the age difference and how that was affecting their dynamic, you know.
And then you get like Marshall Crenshaw on the show, who like whenever you're on my mind is one of my all time favorite. Marshall's been on this show.
He's the best.
He's amazing. I always tell people, I'm like, he's a Detroit guy. Like, he played with the MC5. Like, he's not like the guy's like a badass rock and roller.
He played with the MC5?
Yeah. When they came back, he toured with MC5 for a while. And when they were doing tours when Rob Tynan died. And I saw them when I lived in London in the early 2000s. I saw MC5 with Marshall playing guitar, and then they had revolving singers, and it was Dave Vanian from The Damned and Lemmy from Motorhead.
That's amazing. Yeah, the music on the show, I mean, if you think of a lot of the music that we got from real like indie rockers, like Magnetic Fields, mm-hmm. I mean, that Funny, Sad, Strange, and Beautiful is the Magnetic Field in a nutshell, you know, and that was like, and that was the episode where Artie leaves forever. So it was a good blend of you know, our Puff the Magic Dragon story. You know, it needed Magnetic Fields, and for, you know, we just made it happen. You know, it was really a great bit of serendipity.
Or that what is it? Your Long Wet Fingers, that Magnetic Fields side project.
That's another Magnetic Fields song, right?
But that's like the perfect. It's those four things. Like, it's more than, that's the song I always think of. So you start making the promos. They kind of are leaving you alone, I imagine. You just kind of pitch them. They're like, well, they're 60 seconds. It can't cost that much money. Go for it. We don't really mind.
Yeah. Though at the same time, you know, Scott Webb, who was in charge of the promo department, I mean, it took a lot of trust for him to just, I mean, it was out there enough, and he got it. And they were obviously more expensive than a standard, you know, promo where you cut together footage. But, he committed to it. It really struck a chord with him. And, you know, if it hadn't been for him, we never would have had a chance to do it. And the only sad part of the story with Pete and Pete is that promos won a lot of, you know, the 60-second stories won a lot of awards, and everyone liked them, and they really were, like, considered, like, these gems on the network. But it took about, you know, we did the specials, you know, over the course of, like, 3 years. We did 5 specials, but it took, like, maybe 4.5 years for it to become a series. And meanwhile, the kids said, as I often say in the reunions, it's like so many wasted years of Little Pete being cute, you know?
And then, Danny's not still cute. What are you talking about?
So it did take a long time for like the programming department, like, which is not the promo department, to say, well, let's give it a try. And I don't think they were ever satisfied with the, I mean, it's so weird to think of, you know, the SNCC programming block on Friday night. Which, you know, was Nickelodeon putting its slickest, you know, most popular shows on display. You know, P&P was in that mix, and, you know, I don't think it ever had, you know, it was just not like the other shows. And I think that, you know, it's become cult status has led it to live in people's memories and minds for all these years. And maybe that's better than being popular at the time, because if
you're not Roundhouse,
you're not Alex Mack.
But you know, it is. Think about it; it is a really weird, hard sell to say, "Hey, can we do promos for a show that's not a show?"
I know. Well, it was really, you know, I think it was. I mean, Nickelodeon was always trying to find ways to tap into, like, you know, what kids think about. You know, it was very, dedicated to the kid point of view back then. And so, you know, this Pete and Pete was probably the most, the deepest dive into that kind of kid point of view part. So I think it just, as weird as it might have been at first, it really hit all the right buttons for what Nick was always trying to do. You know, it's just did it in its own way.
So did you also do Inside Out Boy?
I did. That got a lot. Everyone okay. seems to remember that. There was one spot where he turns and, you know, he goes to the old kid mythology of going over the bar on the
street. Was that only one spot?
No, there was another one. I'm not totally proud of that. I mean, it was a great idea. And the swing one was my favorite. But then I did one that was more like just gratuitously gross. And I think the needle started to move in the wrong direction after that one. I just took it too little. You know, it was just like, he's already gross enough.
Yeah.
We don't need to add some. I think it was something about boogers or something. And I crashed the car with that one.
Well, that was, the network was kind of moving in that direction a little bit anyway by that point. But I remember as a kid, I was always like, man, I'd watch an Inside Out Boy TV show.
It would have been a good show. That's a show you definitely wouldn't want to see live.
Maybe it would. I mean, that would be, just for the hell of it, would be pretty entertaining.
Can you imagine that? Let's get on the school bus. Oh, my God. He was throwing up.
Why is this seat wet?
What's the monster
off? Oh yeah, you could pitch that now. Then I don't think you got anything to do with it, but at the same time, I remember the weirdest thing was "Hi, Honey, I'm Home,"
which
they were Nickelodeon, and I've talked about this in the show before. But for the listener, it was Nick at Night doing original programming, which they had toyed with on and off for years, but never really. There was a fake like Siskel and Ebert type show. They did a season of the Mad Movies with the LA Connection, but nothing really hit. And so they did this show, "Hi, Honey, I'm Home," which was very high concept 60s. It was 60s, you know, Donna Reed type family living in the today world. But they called it an instant rerun because it was a deal they did with ABC that the show would air Friday night on TGIF, and then a rerun of that episode would air Sunday nights on Nick at Night. So still a rerun.
That's so crazy that they, that was probably the last gasp of trying to stay connected to the original vision of Nick at Night, right? People don't come to Nick at Night to see shows that aren't reruns. So when you look back at it though, it's just like, what does that even mean? It seems like a framing device that makes no sense at all.
Oh yeah. I mean, especially now where we don't even have traditional TV seasons and stuff's not, do we even have reruns anymore because shows don't have to air all year round just because they're not making new episodes. It's something that felt like we would have it forever because we were used to it growing up that doesn't make a ton of sense and isn't a thing now. And of course it isn't.
I know. I was thinking, it just popped in my head, was maybe the most, either the most Nick at Night or most subversive or just the furthest extension of self-deprecation was, I don't know if you saw these ads that aired, in that period. It was, we'd get a semi-famous celebrity, somebody you knew from TV or, just a B-grade celebrity. And the voiceover, you'd see the person and the voiceover would say, so-and-so talks about why he loves Nick at Night. And then you go, I never actually watched it, but I know a guy who does. And he says it's pretty good.
Yes. I do recall those. I think, did Dick Van Patten do one?
It was great. Yeah. Sounds great. It's just no. Nah, I never watched it. That was Tom Hill came up with those. He was my childhood friend and cohort on Nick at Night promo department. And, I think he had the funny and the sad and the strange. I just don't think he was going for beautiful. He was just going for complete and utter straight faced, undermining of the network. But at the same, I guess there was some love to it. It was just it was the underdog spirit. It's always fun to be the underdog, and we always were that. So that spot's just underdog stuff, I guess. So that's a pretty good spin for it. But yeah
it's like an anti promo.
Yeah, so many celebs are just going,
it's heard of it.
It's 10 seconds long, and it really pulled the rug out on most testimonials.
But I still see the influence of that in Adult Swim and their interstitials, and that it's so very similar to that sort of approach, which is amazing. So once Pete and Pete ended, was that when you got the deal with ABC?
Yeah.
So and then you went right into Snow Day?
We did Snow Day in that period, and we did a show the first year on the deal. We did a Pete and Pete-ish show. And so that's one major lesson I talked about, like, the show doesn't really make you laugh. It makes you feel, and it makes you nostalgic and everything else. But, you know, there's a lot of sight gags, but it's not, like, designed in its dialogue to really make you laugh. The other thing we learned the hard way was in this ABC show that they made, and it didn't, you know, it didn't go to series. It didn't test very well. It was the Pete and Pete, like, world with, you know, all the things you'd expect. But it was told from the perspective, it was a family show, so it was told from the perspective, like, and Pete and Pete, the parents were just kind of in the background, and they were just, like, 50s, yeah. You know, caricatures. And so the kid point of view could reign supreme, but they wanted it to be a family show. Obviously, it's for ABC, and so there was the dad was the voiceover, and it was his point of view and his story. And what we learned the hard way is, like, there's a big disconnect when it's from an adult point of view. It just doesn't work.
Yeah, right? It's
like, who's this? Why is this guy, like, you know, crying in his, like, his chocolate milkshake? You know, it's just because, you know, some minor reason, and it just you know, I wouldn't even say
he just seems crazy now.
Yeah, it just feels like there's no entry point for it if it's a grown up act thinking like a kid. You know, you think we would have learned our lesson, but I think we just thought our formula was bulletproof, and then we realized you kind of got to have it be from a kid point of view.
I think the formula is bulletproof if people aren't messing with it.
I know. Well, like, Christmas Story is always like a reference point, and that had an adult doing a voiceover, but he was just basically telling you what the kid was thinking. So they got away with it.
Same with Wonder Years. It was almost never a reflective, this is me now talking about then, because then it makes you question the show as well, because the nature of memory and stuff. I even think, you know, subconsciously you're like, well, did that happen if he's making this kind of editorial comment about it or something?
You're right. That show went all the way with, I wish we'd thought of that for our show, because you're right. Daniel Stern was like riffing and like saying all kinds of things that a kid wouldn't have been thinking about, but you know, didn't matter because you had this authority figure, adult, telling you it did and it worked. You know?
Yeah. Yeah. It's like that John Hughes quote from Breakfast Club, which I used to go back and forth on thinking was brilliant or stupid, which is, I think Molly Ringwald's character says, like, when you grow old, your heart dies, or might be Ally Sheedy. But it kind of makes sense because, you know, to your point with the adult crying in his milkshake, it's like the everything being this sort of life or death first time you experience it feels right as a kid. But as an adult, you're like, grow up. You know,
it's true. Did you ever see, now that we're like, it's so fun to be talking to someone who's seen, you know, all the Pete and Pete shows, but since we're kind of like deconstructing stuff.
Yeah.
The one time, mom didn't, you know, mom already had her built in gimmick with the metal plate, mm-hmm. like, you know, foolproof. And then, dad, you know, was usually just like, you know, just being a nudge, except for that Rolling Thunder episode. But also, in the two-part Artie, Goodbye to Artie sequence, he had a pretty big part to play. You know, he was like double-crossing Artie, and, you know, he had to pretend that he was, you know, actually on the side of good. And he had some scenes with Artie. Like, those are the polar opposites of the show. And
yeah.
It kind of worked, you know. The beauty of working on that show is, like, we didn't know anything. So, like, I'm being wise about the show in ways I never had to deal with when I was making it. I just made it, and I didn't think about it that much. That's why it would be hard to reproduce Pete and Pete, you know, because I know too much, and we keep getting in the way. But dad, you know, like, if I was working on the show now, I'd be like, now dad and Artie cannot be on the same scene. They're just like different universes. But somehow, I guess from a kid's point of view, it worked.
Well, yeah, because it was sort of ambiguous that Artie was a real person,
right,
for up till that point. Like, you wondered if it was someone that only the kids could see, or if it was a guy. This will sound like an odd analogy, but like After Hours and Vampire's Kiss are two movies I really love.
Yeah.
And the sort of conceit of those, especially Vampire's Kiss, is like, oh, you know, you see a crazy guy talking to himself on the street. How did he get there? you know, right. And that sort of Vampire's Kiss. And so I always, to a degree, wondered up until that part, if Artie was that sort of thing where the kids see him as the superhero, but adults see him as a totally different, like, sad thing from the outside, you know, Nicolas Cage sees himself as a vampire, but people see him as a homeless, crazy guy, you know? And so that was the kind of, that was kind of how I looked at it, which is how I justified Dad being like against him without being like villainous. 'Cause he really thought he was doing what was best for the kids. If the kids are hanging out with some weird guy that does, you know, he doesn't see them the same way the kids do, literally.
Right. And he never did until that episode where he really, you know, he was responsible for getting Artie to come back, you know, so it's a big moment for that character.
But then you have, you know, characters that are already like later, like Inspector 34, who are like, yeah, the kid's version of an adult almost.
Yeah, that's a good example of a character that we got to create that, you know, nobody objected to. I was thinking about that when I was coming up with ideas to talk about today. You know, you saw the episode. It's, you know, we got away with stuff that seems inconceivable now. A guy who has a connection to a little boy because he's been inspecting his underwear for years comes out and wants to be his friend. You know, it's like,
but it feels wholesome somehow. Like, you pull it off.
I know. I guess it's just because, I don't know, if you're used to that universe, you know, you're not going to think, oh, I guess that's the town pervert. You know, it's just like he's, cause you know, he learns a lesson at the end about, like, it's not always about being neat, you know? And so, that's a good kid message, you know? And, but you know, that comes out of like pretty much every good idea you ever had, back in those days. Like, yeah, who, like, you know, we've all seen those inspected by tags on our clothes. And you start thinking, who's this person? What do they do? What's it like to just inspect underwear, you know? And we got to take something that primal, from our memories, and we just made a whole show about it, you know?
Or even like the Johnny Earwax one with Adam West, like, it's almost a similar relationship where Adam West is, West's character is obsessed with these kids doing that sort of up with people Johnny Earwax thing, which is weird because they seem to have not aged since he was a child. So I'm like, are these some sort of weird like avatars? Yeah. But that doesn't feel creepy, and it could, you know, like this high school principal who's like so excited for these kids to like that he looks up to in a weird way.
Oh, yeah. That was a great episode that brought like the bad guys and the good guys together, right? And they all united to defeat the stupid, you know, Christian-esque, you know,
yes. Department. Well, that was Paper Cut, right? Was he the villain in that one?
No,
it was.
I think it was Adam. Wasn't Adam West? Oh no, it was probably our worst villain. It was the successor to. It was Open Face first, and then it was.
Yes.
I can't remember who number two was, but
the sweaty kid.
Oh right, yeah, his name. Yeah, he was like he had glandular problems.
And yes,
so he was always sweating, which, in looking back, felt like a little beneath our high standards. But he became the bad guy for like season three, I think. You know,
it was hard. It was because Endless Mike is such a great character, and was such the perfect version of that character, but was a Big Pete villain. So yeah. I feel like it was difficult to find sort of Little Pete's Endless Mike, like it there.
Yeah.
But that Endless Mike character, I'm fascinated by. Like, it's such a weird, complicated character. Was that you that came up with?
We came up with. We wanted to have an adult bully, and we were lucky enough to find Rick. You know, who played him to perfection, and I think, you know, things just fell together, you know, once I don't even think we knew exactly what we were going to do with him until we met Mike. And then we thought, this guy looked like a guy who would really be into shop, you know? And in that episode, you know, he went through a bit of a trajectory, and I bet people have different, I don't know if you had different views of, like, he started off as being a pretty realistic guy in Tool and Die, where he was just like a shop, like, you know, acolyte of Mr. Slurm. And he was funny because he was like one of those guys we all know. It's just like he's everywhere else in school. He's a pariah, but in shop, he's king, you know?
Oh yeah.
And most of his commentary was about that sort of like pride and arrogance that only existed in that space. And he would push people around because once class was over, he's going to go back to being like a ding dong. And, and then by season three, you know, it was very cartoony when he was like, you know, in the wrestling episode, you know, he was trying to make weight and he would take out his own spleen, you know, and killed somebody with a hand blower, you know. And so we went way over the top with him by that point. But season three was its own animal, and I'm not a huge fan of season three. Two, I think, was the best. But between two and three, they said you got to try harder to make, you know, they kind of wanted to round off some of the edges of what we did in season two, because we made some controversial episodes. And there's some great season three episodes, but I think shows like the wrestling one are too over the top for my taste. But, you know,
what were some of the season two ones that they particularly objected to?
Well, the one that almost got the show canceled, we had to make part of the concessions we made to the return for season three and make shows that were more cartoony was the one about the baseball team that got hooked on Orange Lazarus.
Orange Lazarus, yeah.
Yeah, because
it is good and frosty.
I know, that was great. You know, now there's a real Oppenheimer movie coming out. I can take pride in my initial.
Yeah.
I've become, I think even the guy who makes the slushy said, I've become,
it's the I am become death line, but yeah.
But somehow with slushies included. And also, too, if this is another example of like getting away with stuff that would seem inconceivable. You know, when Little Pete was joined the team because he was such a great trash talker, he both insinuated with one line to the guy at the plate that he may have masturbated with hot shaving cream lather. Yep. And then also held up a sign and said, hey, you want to see how a colt becomes a gelding? You know, and said, oh, castration joke. All that was a season two episode. So that's an example of it. So it was the drugginess of the, bad drug trip the kids were having when they froze their brains. And I think just in general, there was more, we're taking more chances, and finally somebody noticed, you know.
Well, you know, you got to push the envelope as far as you can go. But season three does have some great ones, and there is some. Endless Mike almost becomes like a Damone type character at some, you know, at points in that season where, you know, especially the drive-in one, or, you know, he becomes sort of like weirdly like a bullshit mentor.
Yeah,
and I like
the one. Yeah, but the time tunnel one where he's like, you know, Pete's like love tutor, you know, was a totally different side of him, you know. But he kind of just, you know, decided to give this dork a break, you know, and make him benefit from his his wisdom about the ladies. So that was a nice way to sort of see him as like a facilitator, not just a dick, you know?
Oh yeah, absolutely. And then of course, season three, you know, you have the Dance Fever episode, which I really like.
Yeah, that was a good one. Maybe I'm wrong about that. I think I'm just overreacting, but I love Saturday, and in a way I can't, what were the other good ones in season three? The Driver's Ed one was to me a real sore spot because we couldn't get the actor who played Slurm the first time. So it was a completely new guy who we called Mr. Slurm. That felt like a real sellout to me.
Yeah, that was a little bit weird. But yeah, I mean, I haven't revisited that season as much as I would have liked to because the infamous DVD issue, although I do have copies. But yeah, I love seeing... you know, like Julian Hatfield pop up and yeah. Lush Jackson pop up. And it's in hindsight, when you compare it to some of the garbage that was on other stations, like still, even Pete and Peter at its worst, it's so much better than most of the other stuff at its best, you know?
That's true. I mean, how can you go wrong with the Dance Fever that has Iggy Pop singing to his daughter, you know?
Yes. That's another one I mentioned. And I think, you know, I went to the first reunion, and I think that's the first time I heard this story, but Iggy Pop was just going to be in the one episode, and you guys got a phone call from his management who was like, Jim would like to come back tomorrow.
I know. It was amazing. That's probably the most happiest, unexpected, I guess success story, because, to get him once is one thing. And then like, you know, he got to say great things, you know, he was like, he's probably one of our, like a lot of the cameos were great just because like, you know, they were people you wouldn't expect, like Patty Hearst. But, he was actually really hilarious. You know, he's so low voice and kind of, he was part of the international adult conspiracy. And he had, he had some great lines.
Were there ever people that you just wrote sort of parse for because you wanted to meet him?
Well, we were scared of Iggy Pop. I mean, we may have said that in the reunion. Like, we should do another take. I think it's too big. You want to tell him? I'm not going to tell him. You know?
Yeah.
And, But he was great. He was probably one of the best things in Snow Day, too, you know?
Yes.
Just because he's, you know, there's nobody like him. But I would say people who, you know, read anything about the show probably know this, but what was the most transformative cameo we ever had that got us into, like, Spin Magazine and stuff was Michael Stipe as Captain Scrummy. Once we got that guy, you know, that was a friend of the director's, Katherine Dieckmann. So once he miraculously, you know, played that part so weirdly, it kind of, you know, almost like it was like we felt like we'd connected with, like, you know, somebody who could be, I mean, just the way he normally is, he could have been Mr. Scrummy, you know?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
So we didn't have to exaggerate into it. So it was just like that kind of, that mixture of, like, famous person who actually seems to inhabit the spirit of the show coming together. And, you know, I don't know if every cameo pulled that off, but it gave us a vision for, like, what a great sympathetic cameo could do for the show.
Because that was Katherine Dieckmann, I think, and she directed Shiny Happy People.
A lot of them. She was the one that was there from the beginning with the 60s. She was kind of like the director, you know, who presided over the visual vocabulary of the show. And, you know, we had to get more directors once we did the series. But she did a lot of the best episodes. And she was the most, you know, because she was there from 62nd spot number one. You know, she lived and breathed that show like nobody else could.
Was there anyone you worked with that you had watched on TV growing up? Like, obviously, Adam West is an example, but that you were really intimidated by or intimidated to work with? Pete and Pete or anything?
I do remember. Did you ever see the episode where Pete, where we spend most of the time at the driving range? Dad's
yes.
driving
range? Yes.
So, you know, the director, Chris Koch, you know, at some point, maybe the year before, had bought something off of eBay, and it was a golf club that had a little Frank Gifford plastic Frank
yep.
Action figure at the bottom that would swing his golf club.
I bought one just because of that episode, by the way.
I have one. In terms of, like, meta, have Frank Gifford himself just not even like making it, you know, completely deadpan, using that club at a driving range. It might be the ultimate meta moment from the whole series.
Because you have to know it's him, too. Like, it's, you don't even, like, really, you don't go out of your way to point it out that it's like, oh, look, it's like.
No, well, Dan's running around going, you know, gifts here, you know, get your act together. that little club with the little man. I don't know. I think it was Arnold Palmer. It wasn't.
It's Arnold Palmer, yeah.
Yeah, it could have been different. But just the fact that he, I heard later that his wife had to talk him into it. He had no idea what he was doing, you know.
That sounds about right.
It's kind of comforting, actually. If he knew, then we'd wonder why he seemed such a you know, I don't know. You know, he didn't seem like he had much of a sense of humor.
Well, it was extra weird then that the person talking him into it is Kathy Lee Gifford.
I know. I think she's a little more sane about, like, I don't know. I don't know what their relationship was like, but when he showed up that day, we were all really scared. Like, is he going to look at this club and just, like, beat us to
right.
death?
Right. What, are you making a fool of me? Well, like, infamously, that reminds me, like, John Cusack went nuts. Have you heard this about him and Savage Steve Holland?
No.
So he was in Better Off Dead, which I love. And again, very sort of similar kind of aesthetic to Pete and Pete. And while they were shooting One Crazy Summer, they did a cast and crew screening of Better Off Dead. And Cusack halfway through storms out. And he's like, what the hell? You made me look ridiculous. And he's like, what are you talking about? And he's like, I didn't know this was a comedy. And, like, I've talked to Curtis Armstrong, and he's like, everything in the movies in the script, like, there's no way. And so Cusack refused to talk to Savage Steve Holland for the rest of that movie or ever again. And he won't talk about those movies because he was like, you made me look like a fool.
I can imagine Steve saying, you know, my name is Savage Steve, right? You know,
right. You know, I invented the whammy. Like, that's who you're working with here in this movie called One Crazy Summer. Yeah. So you never know. Like, someone like Frank Gifford would be like, wait, what is this kind of thing? You're making me look like a fool.
Yeah. I don't think, you know, one person that really rejected, didn't know what he was getting into and was really grouchy about it was in Snow Day, like Chevy Chase. And, you know, like,
well,
we have Chevy Chase, and then we're like, oh shit, we have Chevy Chase. He was just like rewriting stuff all the time, and I don't know what he wanted to make it into. I guess he wanted to make it into like one of his vacation movies, maybe. But
yeah, but nobody likes Chevy. I know.
Did you see his roast? Did you see Chevy's roast?
I did. Yeah, yeah.
That was like torture. I mean, he deserved it. Just the just seeing him put, like, just melting, you know?
Yeah, it's, I do feel bad for him in a lot of ways. Like, Lorraine Newman's a friend, and Lorraine is, like, one of the only people I've ever heard say nice things about Lorne Michaels. And, she doesn't even like Chevy, I don't think.
Like, he was great. Did you think he was great in Caddyshack?
Oh, yeah. I mean, he was great in all, like, Fletch. I even, the Fletch movies are perfect. Like, his whole probably first 10 movies are just hilarious. Like, even, like, Sale of the Century, Seems Like Old Times, or, like, Modern Problems, which would not be great movies. Like, he really is great in them. But man, what an unpleasant guy. Like, to this day, like, I have a lot of friends that worked on Community and are just like, oh, good God.
did you ever hear what Bill Murray said to Chevy Chase when they were, like, physically, like, they had to be held apart because they wanted to fight on the
back? No.
Classic line. Bill Murray's just, like, shouting, you know, in this melee, medium talent. You kind of think, yeah, that's kind of a good way to put it, you know?
Seems pretty accurate.
Think about, like, the first year of SNL, you know, like, the, you know, I was pretty young and I didn't know the term meta, but when I saw Chevy Chase playing the president, but without any attempt.
Not even trying, yeah.
And the way, you know, just the slapstick and just the kind of, like, he was, you know, he was pretty hip and cool and kind of, like, had his, he was probably the cool, you know, other than Belushi.
Oh, yeah.
He's had a savoir-faire about him. And throughout that, you know what, it was, I don't think he was even there for the whole first season before he left.
No.
But the newscaster, you know, Weekend Update guy, I could watch those forever. He's just kind of, like, ditzy and, you know, kind of out of it. And
it's perfect. It's perfect.
Charming and dim-witted. There's no equivalent to the kind of, like, that persona that was, you know, there've been all kinds of different personas doing that job, but he was just, like, in his, on his own plane on that show.
Yeah, and he set the tone in a way that they've been chasing since then.
Yeah.
Like, literally, this not even the whole first season. We're, what, 40-something seasons later, and they're still, you know, trying to chase that tone from that first one, regardless of who's doing it, which is kind of amazing.
It's one of my comedy, like, reference points. Just, it was also like a, it happened for 9 months, and then it never happened again. So it's kind of, yeah, like, you got to be there, you know?
Speaking of SNL, like, you guys, by filming, you know, you're in New Jersey, but, you know, by being based out of New York instead of California for a kid show was kind of weird, but you got to draw upon, like, these weird New York theater actors, and, like, I think that was probably a big part of it, right?
Yeah. Who's the actor that played, big name actor who was in all kinds of movies, including, you know, the actor who played the barber in the last episode?
Oh, yes.
And we had, you're right, we had a lot of stage actors that showed up. William Hickey, you know?
Yes, William Hickey, who's in One Crazy Summer as well.
Here's my impression of William Hickey. Drink it, it's milk.
The blessing. He was not as old as he seemed as well, I believe.
Oh, man, he was like, looked like he was 100 years old. But
yeah, I think he was like 60.
That's hard to believe.
I think Bobcat told me that. Like, he was like, because we did One Crazy Summer with him, and Mark, what's his name from Animal House, was playing Hickey's son, and he wasn't that much younger than him.
That's hard to believe. Yeah, I wasn't that familiar with his work, and I saw, you know, Pritzy's Honor and other things, and I was like, wow, how did we get this guy? You know, I mean, can't imagine he would watch the show. So,
J.K. Simmons. J.K. Simmons, yes, who's gone on to be so much great stuff now. Is there anything that you've done that you feel like maybe is underseen or that you would want more people to check out?
That's a good question. Well, War Next Door is a prime example. You know, it was like, you know, it was about adults, but because one was a super spy and one was an evil villain, there was like a cartoonish element kind of built into it. And what was great about it was, along with all the gags and, you know, Kriegman as, like, you know, kind of a supervillain that was kind of, you know, dope, was that all the best episodes were these, you know, basically Kriegman wanted to, he moved to suburbia after, you know, the super spy quit, you know, the CIA in order to be like a normal family man. And because they've been trying to kill each other for years and years, like a weird kind of like bond had been created. Like,
right.
And so that bond was in evidence, you know, the whole episode's about them trying to murder each other. And then they would hug at the end, you know? So it was like, you could see that was a love relationship, even though they were trying to kill each other. And that's kind of a complex idea. But when you think about it, that's what made it interesting. You know, it's like both guys are fish out of water. It's like both guys are fish out of water, you know, not one person. And all they had, and they had this connection of just killing each other. And, you know, he was torn between being a suburban dad and wanting to do what he used to do, which is, you know, kill bad guys. And all the love between them always made the show feel like something special. And I wish I felt like something that could have real legs to it. If it'd been on, you know, whatever, a network that had more sort of subversive material, you know, we could have done 10 seasons.
Yeah, I agree. And people can check out some of those episodes on YouTube, as you said. Yeah. And that relationship reminds me of sort of the Batman Joker relationship, where people talk about, like, why doesn't the Joker just kill Batman? He knows he's Bruce Wayne. He knows this. And it's because then he wouldn't have a reason to be the Joker anymore.
I know. They need each other. And, you know, it's kind of a codependent relationship.
Yeah, totally. Yeah. Well, thank you so much for doing this. As I said, I've wanted to talk to you for a really long time. And this was a great, great chat. I appreciate
it. Format. I mean, hopefully, I didn't blab too much, but it was great. I just felt really relaxed, and it was fun just to jump around. And seems like we have a lot of the same reference points, so didn't really feel like an interview. It just felt like two guys talking, which is the best.
There you go. That's Will. What a good dude. His work is a cornerstone in what made me the person I am today. So either thank him or blame him, whatever you want to do. And I can't wait to see that Embarrassment documentary. We Were Famous, You Don't Remember, about the Kansas band, The Embarrassment. Also, if you've never heard them, all their stuff's streaming. There's like there was a CD complete discography. They didn't do a ton of stuff, but Wellsville's on there. You should check that out. And if for some bizarre reason you haven't seen Pete and Pete, do it right now. And watch The War Next Door. There's a few, as Will mentioned, there's a few episodes up on YouTube that you can watch. And, you know, if you're a patron of the show, patreon.com/TV Guidance Counselor, I'm thinking about doing a watch along. So maybe all the patrons will get together. We'll do a live watch along to The War Next Door. So if you're a patron, let me know if you're interested in that, and we'll get it scheduled. If you're not a patron, become one. Even $1 a month will get you in there, in the door, and is a huge help. And we'll make that happen. Also, if you just have any guests that you would like to request I get on the show, or want to talk about anything, I love hearing from you guys. You can email me at tvguidancecounselor@gmail.com. or at kenandikenread.com. Also on all the social media at Kenneth W. Reed and at TV Guidance Counselor. And you know where to find me each and every week, because I'm here. I will be here. And I'll be here next week for a brand new edition of TV Guidance Counselor.
And like, I would say 3/4 of like 200 people said, "When the fat kid farted."